Welcome. This talk presents truncated differential distinguishers on reduced zone AES. My name is Eichlist, and this has been joint work with Chen-Chen Bao and Chen Guo from NTU Singapore. The sum of two independent permutations is a simple construction to turn permutations into a pseudo-random function, where k independent permutations are sampled uniformly at random, and their outputs are simply summed. So the goal of a distinguisher here is to distinguish the outputs from this construction from that of a random function. In the context of provable security, there has been a lot of results. For instance, the results by Bellare or Impagliazzo in 1999 on the sum of two permutations, or already generalizing the work by Lux in 2000. However, there has been a lot more analysis that considered such sums with the conclusion that this construction is close to optimal, indistinguishable from a PRF for up to 2 to n queries, which has been the result of many recent work, for instance by Manning and Nevis in 2017 with mirror theory, or Dai et al. With the chi-square method, and Bhattacharya and Nandi. Even more, it's even indifferentiable from a PRF close to 2 to n queries, so close to the full codebook. From a provable security perspective, the interest quite ends here. One knows that this construction can no longer be secure once a distinguisher has collected 2 to n minus the last query. So clearly, when he has all but the last query, a distinguisher can simply build a sum and then predict what the last value must have been. A noteworthy work by Patarin went beyond this point. He asked himself, what happens if few responses are random? In that case, the simple sum distinguisher does no longer work, and other distinguishing approaches are needed, which motivated his study, and he went on to find other attacks. To exceed this limit of 2 to n queries, Patarin modeled the setting that a distinguisher has access to multiple such sum of permutation instances. That a distinguisher has access to g such constructions and can query up to 2 to n queries on each. The approach he used in his distinguishers then was to count the number of collisions that occurred from pairs of distinct inputs. He found that between the sum of k permutations and a truly random function, the mean and the standard deviations of those number of collisions differed slightly. So he obtained new distinguishers given sufficiently many queries. Here, this is illustrated just as an example for q2 to the 8 queries per experiment and over 8-bit permutations. What you can see from the results is that for the sum of two PRPs, the expectation is close to 2 to n half. This is 128 in this example. While for a random function, the sum is close to 2 to n minus 1 half, which is 127.5 in this tiny example. Given enough queries, one can distinguish those constructions still from random. Patarin considered k permutations and found a general formula which yields the probability of a collision as 1 by 2 to n plus or minus some term that depends on the number of permutations. The question you could ask here, what does this have to do with differentials or with the AES? In fact, it has implications for integral attacks. We had the following observation independently, but during our work we found that Janet Al, in their 2015 paper, had a similar observation earlier in a slightly different context. So they deserve the credits for that. Their core observation was that an integral distinguisher usually ends with some linear operation. It starts with the propagation of some all subsets, which mean all values in a certain subset, and their context were substitution permutation networks. So in these components, a set of texts iterated over all values. At the end of an integral distinguisher, a linear layer adds these components and destroys this all property, but still transforms it into some other balance property or zero-sum property. This means if all values in a subset or subspace are used, they will sum to zero. After the linear layer, the sum will be preserved. However, The next nonlinear layer will destroy this property, and the integral distinguisher will end. What they observed is that the linear layer in many primitives behaves similar to a sum of permutations. For instance, an affine layer consists of a matrix multiplication with, for instance, some circular matrix and some addition. This matrix multiplication is de facto the sum of the individual components of the input vector. This means if we have components that are summed in the linear layer that iterate over all values, one could potentially approximate this by the sum of independent permutations. The distribution of the number of collisions will then be preserved by the subsequent nonlinear layer, simply because equal inputs to the nonlinear layer will produce equal outputs. Their context was a little different from ours, since Jen et al. Focused on type 2 and Nyberg-type Feisel networks with 4-bit S-boxes. Our target in mind was the well-known integral distinguisher on 3-round AES. As most of you know, having a delta set of plain texts that are constant in all but one value and iterate over all values in some cell will yield a 3-round integral distinguisher, where after 2.5 rounds, before the last mixed columns operation, all cells in a state will iterate over all values. The mixed columns operation in round 3 is then a matrix that sums 4 cells each, which can be approximated maybe by a sum of permutations. As a consequence, the distribution of collisions is then maintained through the S-box in a subsequent round. We will extend this then in the following, and note that since mixed column is a linear operation, we can invert it in the last round and simply neglect the last such operation. Of course, our work is not the only one that studied distinguishers on 5 and more rounds of AES recently. The hope in such round-reduced distinguishers was to escape from the previous local maximum of attacks that brought computational improvements, but got somehow stuck at about 7 rounds of AES 128. The hope was to find better attacks in the long run by discovering different strategies. The first such results were key-dependent, like the key-dependent integral by Sun et al. However, this was the start of a series of research. Some cornerstone works were made by Krassi et al., who introduced, for instance, multiple of n distinguishers and mixture differentials. Those led not only to the best round-reduced attacks in 5 rounds, but also motivated the current best distinguishers on up to 6 rounds by mixture attacks by Bardet and Wernjom. There's also a similar work to ours by Krassi and Rechberger, who also considered truncated differential distinguishers and also the variance for cryptanalysis of round-reduced AES, both with small biases. So, in sum, this all is an interesting topic, but many things are still in the dark and require more research. In our work, we adopt the statistical framework by Krassi. When we have two probabilities, p-rand for some collision probability of a random function, and for instance PAS, sometimes we'll use a similar one, for the collision probability of the AS, where sigma AS and sigma rand are then the standard deviations of the random function and the AS accordingly. Given this statistical framework, we can say that for success probability of distinguishing PS, the number of experiments, so the number of pairs we need to collect, must satisfy the following formula, where this is the inverse error function. Let's say we can approximate mixed columns at the end of round 3 as the sum of 4 independent permutations. Then, Patarin's formula gives us a collision probability of about 2 to minus 8 plus some additional term of about 2 to minus 32, whereas for a random truncated permutation, the probability for a byte collision is roughly 2 to minus 8. If we use enough pairs, the small addend of 2 to minus 32 will become distinguishable. Given the formula from before, for a distinguishing success probability of 95% or higher, we will need somewhat 2 to the 58.4 pairs. If we take delta sets of 2 to the 8 texts, that can be combined to about 2 to 15 pairs, this means we need roughly 2 to the 51.4 chosen plain text. This can be optimized, of course, but we focus on the concept here. While the computational complexity of 2 to the 51 is already somewhat feasible, it's still prohibitive to carry out experiments. We considered a minified variant of the AES, small AES, which had 4-bit cells instead of 8-bit cells as the real AES, by Zitt et al. From their 2005 paper. For this reduced construction, we used the same formula to compute the collision probability for the real small AES of a collision in the after 4 rounds, and the collision probability for a truncated random permutation, where we also compared in 4-bit at the end. Again, for a success probability of 0.95, here we needed now about 2 to the 30 pairs, so 2 to the 27 chosen plain text, and this could be implemented. We implemented our distinguisher on 4 rounds for small AES and used full SPEC 64 with 96-bit key as a random permutation. We used 100 random keys and random delta sets and see that for 2 to the 23 delta sets, both distributions can be distinguished well. The distinguisher works better than expected, while the truncated random permutation behaves close to the expectation with 62,950 versus 940. Small AES hits many more collisions in a single cell after 4 rounds than we would project it. We come to that later. From that point, we could extend the 4-round distinguisher to 5 rounds. Instead of considering a single cell after 4 rounds, we can consider 4 collisions in a diagonal at a time that lead to an inactive entire diagonal after 5 rounds without the final mixed columns operation. For the real AES, the probability would become 2 to the minus 32 plus some additional term in the order of 2 to the minus 54. Whereas for a random truncated permutation, it would be roughly 2 to the minus 32. If we consider any entire diagonal to be inactive, we get about an addend of 2 to the minus 52 for the reconstruction, whereas it would be about minus 2 to the minus 61.4 for a random truncated permutation. Using the same formulas, we obtain for a success probability of again about 0.95 about 2 to the 76.4 pairs. We could somewhat optimize this if we use structures, for instance, structures that contain pairs from a column or a diagonal and would have 2 to the 32 texts each. Then we could form 4 times 2 to the 24 times 2 to the 8 by 2 pairs from such a structure. We would need 2 to the 36 structures of that and would get about 2 to the 77 pairs. The memory of such a distinguisher would be dominated by storing 2 to the 32 states in some array or hash table and having 4 lists at the end for the inverse columns of the ciphertexts. The time would be then dominated by having 2 to the 73 memory accesses and 2 to the 68 encryptions. This distinguisher is not feasible. However, to verify our results, we conducted a similar experiment with the small AES variant. For that, the probability for having at least one inactive entire diagonal after 5 rounds was 2 to the minus 14 plus an addend in the order of 2 to the minus 24. Whereas for a truncated random permutation with 4-bit cells, it would be marginally lower than 2 to the minus 14. Again, to have a success probability of 0.95 or higher, we would need here about in the order of 2 to the 36 pairs. So this was feasible, and we could implement this similar as before. We took again small AES, and here in red, and SPEC 64, here shown in blue, as a pseudo-random permutation. Both distributions are well distinguishable with enough data sets. The random world again matches the expectation quite well. However, again, the results for small AES slightly exceeded the predicted theory. We conducted a similar experiment with a variant of the small AES where we only replaced the S-box by that of present and found that the result differed greatly. In this small setting, we found that there are considerable dependencies of the S-box. This is given and investigated a little more in our paper, but shall be just illustrated here for the moment. While our distinguishers are somewhat inferior to those by Grassi and Rechberger, they have one significant advantage. Since they start from a single active byte, one can easily prepend a round. So, we could derive a six-round key recovery from our five-round distinguisher by guessing 4 bytes of a diagonal of the initial round key. More details can then be found in the paper. Here, we consider the statistical frameworks by Selçuk, as well as the updated framework by Zameida and Sarkar in their paper. Optimal configurations of the advantages in bits A and the computational complexity are then at around 2 to 70 chosen plain text in Selçuk's model and 2 to 77.5 encryptions, and at about 2 to 71.3 chosen plain text and about 2 to 78.7 encryptions in Zameida and Sarkar's model. To have a proof of concept, we implemented our key recovery attack again for the small version of the AES, the 4-bit S boxes, and tried to recover the value of the first diagonal of the initial round key, and used 2 to 15, 2 to 16, and 2 to 17 structures to have a proof of concept, and showed how many times the correct key was among the top 20 up to the top 100 keys, and found that for 2 to 15 structures it was half of the time among the top 100 keys, for 2 to 16 structures about 92 times, and for 2 to 70 structures always in the top 100, actually in the top 30. The interesting point now has been a simple idea. For our five-round distinguisher, we started from a single active cell. For the key recovery on six rounds, we had guessed the four key cells of a diagonal in the first round. The idea was now to ask, what happens if we consider all pairs in such a diagonal? A fraction of correct pairs will have a single active cell after the first round. For those, the collision probability after six rounds will have the same bias as in our five-round distinguisher. The remaining pairs hopefully should behave expectably close to the probability of a truncated random permutation. If they would not, we would have a second distinguisher for those. However, if the collision probability is sufficiently close to that of a truncated random permutation, the bias from the good pairs would still be detectable, and this bias should be much smaller, but maybe still exploitable. Again, we consider any inactive diagonal after almost six rounds. For a truncated random permutation, this holds with probability roughly 2 to minus 30, whereas for six rounds of AES, we would get an additional addend of the order 2 to minus 74. Here we neglect, of course, much smaller terms. This means the difference would be tidy, about 2 to minus 74. However, if we use the same formula as before, for success probability around 0.95, we would need roughly 2 to 120.5 pairs for a distinguisher. Using diagonal structures of 2 to 32 texts, with roughly 2 to 63 pairs, we would need about 2 to 57 structures with 2 to 89.5 chosen plain texts. It would be great to have some kind of verification for that. If we scale this approach down for the small AES again, we would get a probability for a random truncated permutation about 2 to minus 14, whereas for 6 rounds of smaller AES, we get an additional term in the order of 2 to minus 34. Here, we would need about 2 to 56.2 pairs, which means when we start from these structures, we would need about 2 to 41.2 chosen plain text per experiment. And this was practical enough. We implemented this again with small AES and with full round Spec64 as a pseudo-random permutation. We used 100 experiments of random keys and structures and found, with sufficiently many data, we can distinguish both distributions quite well, similar to theory. The pseudo-random outcome is again very close to the expected value. The real small AES overshoots our expected value. Note that these standard deviation values are for one structure, whereas each experiment consists of about 2 to 25 structures, so the difference is significant.
Besides Padrón's sum of permutation, we employed two further approaches to verify our theoretical probabilities. Once, we used the proof method following the footsteps by Grassi and Rechberger, which had two assumptions: that the S-box was ideal, and that any combination of input and output positions is equally successful in our distinguishers. Second, we employed Runyom's truncated differential propagation matrices, which yielded the same probabilities as in our approach of using the sum of permutations. In sum, we observed the same probabilities for all three approaches. Nevertheless, they did not completely model the real-world setting.
We tried to refine our analysis in our paper and considered two kinds of parameters. First, index dependencies, which means at which position we used an active input cell in the plaintext and which output cells were considered. Second, we considered effects of using different S-boxes in small layers. Those results will be presented at the end and can be found in our paper. To sum up, we started from Paderin's sum of permutations and approximated the mixed columns operation at the end of the three-round integral distinguisher as a sum of four independent permutations. We derived a four-round truncated differential distinguisher, extended it to five rounds by considering multiple output cells, and showed a key recovery on six rounds. Moreover, we exemplified that we also could consider all pairs in a diagonal structure and could mount a distinguisher on six rounds with some tiny advantage, but which seemed to work. We cross-verified our theoretical distinguishers with two further approaches. First, the proof by Krasin-Reschberger under some assumptions, and second, the differential propagation matrices by Runyom. All our experiments were tried to be implemented with a small version of the AES, the code to which is publicly available. Moreover, for the six-round distinguisher, we used the NIST randomness beacons as pseudo-random keys. These values are public, and you should get hopefully exactly our results when you consider also the same keys. Moreover, we proposed a natural extension of our five-round distinguisher to a six-round key recovery and implemented a proof of concept, again with the small AES. We see that small bias distinguishers can become useful and would like to explicitly recommend the equally rigorous paper by Krasin-Reschberger to you and note that we built upon their statistics and proof methods. We found interesting dependencies and deviations from our theoretical probabilities by varying the input and output indices of which cells were interesting for our distinguisher and by varying the S-boxes in small AES. We could somehow also follow or substantiate the claim that Krasin-Reschberger already put up that the more uniform an S-box is, the better it is, the lower the deviations from theory are. The precise reasons behind that are still unclear. We have only indications. However, we have also indications that the deviations that you saw, for instance, for the present S-box, are mostly due to the small size of the small AES, and we found much smaller deviation when we considered equation systems for our four-round distinguisher for the real AES. So far to say, thank you for your attention. There is a significant deviation from the theory and our analysis. We tried to consider two kinds of parameters, as said before. One is the influence of the active input cells and the concerned collisions in the output cells, so the positions of which cells are relevant. And the second parameter would be what happens if we replace the S-box in small AES or in the real AES with a different one. First, let us consider how different combinations of input and output indices affect our distinguishers. So here, I-in considers the position of the input cell, I-out the position of the output cell. And just as a comparison metric, we try to plot them in the following, in multiples of the deviation from the real experiments to the random permutation. What do our indices mean? For instance, IN of 1 would mean that this would be our active input cell, and I out of 0 would be that we consider collisions in the 0th output cell. We found that we could construct an equation system that differs in the factors depending on the positions. For four rounds, this is also feasible to compute, and we get four terms per output cell. For example, here, for the first input cell and the first output cell. Of course, the equations differ naturally for different in and output positions. This was feasible for four rounds, as said, and we could plot this for all combinations. This is illustrated in multiples of the difference between number of collisions for the truncated random permutation and the experiments found. A value of 0 would mean that there is no distinguisher, whereas a value of 1 would be that distinguisher works as expected. For any value that exceeds plus minus 1, we would get an even better distinguisher. What you can see here is that in theory, given our equation system, there are huge deviations and range from somewhat 0 to plus 7 times the difference that we expected. This means that most input-output cell combinations are actually better than expected, so give stronger distinguishers. However, not in the case of using the 0th input cell and the 0th output cell. We also consider the theory for the 8-bit AES. Here, we observe that the deviations are considerably lower than for the small AES. They range from about 1 to 1.35 times the expected difference, which means that any combination of input and output cell works well. We could interpret that the size of the 4-bit S-box and a little number of only 4 rounds produces side effects that cannot be covered by the simply sum of permutations theory. A different parameter is the S-box. We followed the approach by Krassi and Reschberger, who also considered alternative 4-bit S-boxes, 3 from real-world ciphers, Present, Prince, and Pride, and 3 worse S-box with a differential uniformity of 6, 8, or 10. We left all other aspects of small AES as before, and just changed the S-box, and computed then the index-dependent equation system, and found huge deviations in our results. Less in Prince, somewhat more in Present, and much more, for instance, in Pride or Toy 10. Interestingly, the deviations follow both positive as well as negative directions. The arising question is, which S-box properties cause the deviations? Grassi and Reschberger suggest that the variance of the S-box would have a strong effect. We tried to evaluate this a little closer. We also considered random S-boxes with naturally high variance, since random S-boxes are rarely good S-boxes, so to say, as well as known golden and platinum S-boxes from other papers, which were rather good 4-bit S-boxes and had low variance. We then computed for each S-box from our equation system the distance to the expected number of collisions for an input cell. We had, on one hand, the quality of the S-box, on one hand, the results from our experiments. We computed the Pearson correlation of the variance and our matrix DS and found that there is quite some high correlation of 0.81, with a low error probability that this correlation does not exist. The plot illustrates that there seems to be a correlation, and we could somewhat substantiate what Krassi and Reschberger already tried to address. However, we note that a full story would need much more studies, and still the precise reason for when does an experimental distinguisher follow theory how well is still in the dark and is still an interesting open work.